Hi everyone, today I would like to recall my favorite module, that was Future Medicines in my MPharm final year. I like this module because I could prepare my essay beforehand and regurgitate it in the exam hall. It was relatively less stressful since I knew the exam topic before I saw the question paper. I memorized my essay in a few hours and loved the time I spent reciting it while jogging in parks and bathing in toilets. The question was to choose one technology, from three options of nanotechnology and advanced materials, gene therapy and RNA therapeutics or proteins and immunology. After deciding on one technology, I was required to describe three issues. They are: what are the unmet clinical needs in at least two clinical areas? How my chosen technology address these needs and what are the barriers to clinical adoption? I chose nanotechnology and advanced materials because pharmaceutics attract me more than biology. Without further ado, let's start listening to the essay crafted by me.
The technology which fascinates me the most is nanotechnology and advanced materials in two clinical areas, i.e. gastrointestinal and central nervous systems, to tackle unmet clinical needs in replacing damaged livers with 3D-printed organs, delivering insulin with microneedles as well as drugs to the brain with nanoparticles, dendrimers, and advanced material, hydrogel. The first clinical areas is gastrointestinal system, which include liver and pancreas. Let's focus on damage or cirrhotic liver. Liver can be damaged acutely by drugs and severe infections. Otherwise, excess fat in body or alcohol consumption damages liver cells over a long time and leads to prolonged hepatitis and ultimately cirrhosis. Even if the liver can regenerate, once cirrhosis has taken place, its course is often irreversible except in selected cases like treated hepatitis B virus. In addition, cirrhosis can remain asymptomatic for considerable amount of time. No extracorporeal support devices have been approved for liver diseases. Transplantation is the only treatment for patients with end-stage liver diseases currently. However, the supply from live and deceased donors cannot meet the overwhelming demands. Only about a third of patients on the waiting list receive transplants each year. The situation is worsened by increased incidence of liver conditions such as hepatitis C infection, alcohol-driven and obesity-driven fatty liver diseases nowadays, further reducing the number of eligible donor organs.
Whole liver engineering seeks to reproduce the macro and microstructural complexity. Three-dimensional, 3D, bioprinting deposits cells or cells aggregates as tissue constructs directly. This method involves less steps and the conditions are milder than 3D printing, where the acellular 3D scaffolds are seeded with cells after fabrication. Larger structures like venous, arterial and ductular vasculature with large diameters can be made by these technologies with relative ease.
Lobules are functional units of liver and they consist of multiple cell types such as cholangiocytes, endothelial cells, fibroblasts, Kupffer cells, liver sinusoidal endothelial cells, or sex, mesenchymal stem cells, natural killer cells, and stellate cells.
Small biomaterial volumes and individual cells can be spatially patterned in 3D with precise geometries. With advances in 3D bioprinting, researchers successfully fabricated sinusoids, which are tiny blood vessels of the lobules. They are crucial especially in printing liver to prevent the densely populated cells from developing a necrotic core. Unlike typical capillaries found in other tissues, sinusoids are lined by fenestrated undiaphragmed endothelial cells which are discontinuous with each other to allow exposure of blood onto hepatocyte surfaces.
They do not have basement membrane.
To fabricate sinusoids, researchers cast sacrificial substances around the bulk cell-laden material. Next, the printed sacrificial substances are removed, leaving a hollow network. Finally, the network is seeded with endothelial cells like endothelial progenitor cells, EPCs, or human umbilical vein endothelial cells, HUVEX. Two examples of sacrificial substances are Planic F127 ink, which liquefies at lower temperatures, and carbohydrate glass sacrificial ink, which dissolved with water.
The best way of assembling these different parts to produce fully functional liver remain unknown. Poor scalability and extended build time are limiting clinical adoption of 3D bioprinting. Further work may be done to shorten the time from 3 days using a 200 micrometers nozzle to 1 hour using 64 multinozzle array to print 1L adult liver. Besides, more thorough assessment methods beyond hepatocyte viability need to be developed to provide robust measurement of tissue functionalities in vitro and in vivo in line with various functions of liver. The ability of EPCs or HUVECs to differentiate into LSECs has to be confirmed. Further barrier to bioengineer whole liver with intact biliary tract is the lack of advance in regeneration of biliary epithelium.
Another unmet need was in diabetes management. Current treatment for type 1 diabetes and type 2 diabetes uncontrolled by lifestyle modifications and oral agents depends heavily on insulin subcutaneous injections, which can be painful. 1. Some patients refuse to comply with their prescribed insulin regimens because of the pain from insulin injections or finger prick tests, hypoglycemic experiences, complex instructions with insulin SC injections, unsure of how to adjust doses based on finger prick test results, inconvenient to carry around, and complex storage instruction for used and unused pens. The latter becomes bothersome during travel. Adequate control of blood glucose level is difficult to maintain even with tireless self-monitoring and injecting the correct dose of insulin. This is because patients' immediate physiological needs change invariably with daily activities, driving, weather, and so on. Uncontrolled blood glucose leads to serious macrovascular and microvascular complications like leg amputations, blindness, cardiovascular diseases, and kidney problems in the long run. More recent invention, i.e. continuous glucose monitors, CGMs, may help patients to stay in their target blood glucose level most of the time. Main disadvantages is the reading shown reflects the true blood glucose levels in the previous 5 to 15 minutes because it takes time for glucose to diffuse from blood into the interstitial fluid in abdomen when it is being measured by CGM. This is problematic when dosing of insulin depends on blood glucose levels instead of interstitial glucose levels. Other disadvantages of CGMs are frequent calibration, maintenance, replacement, inconvenience of bringing the machine, size of pages around, high cost, and infection risk.
You and colleagues designed smart insulin patch, which is 11 by 11, a total of 121 microneedles, MNs, on a square patch, 6 millimeters by 6 millimeters. They are basically insulin-encapsulated microneedles where insulin is being delivered via hypoxia-sensitive nanoparticles, NPs. These microneedles are fabricated by first loading the nanoparticle solution into silicone molds and centrifuging them. Next, drops of methacrylated hyaluronic acids are added dropwise with binder and photoinitiator. After centrifugation, they are exposed to UV to enable crosslinks formation, resulting in stiffer microneedles and better entrapment of nanoparticles in microneedles. Microneedles penetrate the stratum corneum and then into the viable epidermis. NPs are exposed to glucose in interstitial fluid. Then, glucose is being consumed by glucose oxidase in the core of nanoparticles, creating hypoxia microenvironment. Consequently, 2-nitroimidazole, found in the outer layer of nanoparticles, was being reduced to 2-aminoimidazole. This increased hydrophilicity ruptures the outer layer and releases insulin from the core of nanoparticles. Insulin is being released at basal rate in normoglycemia and increased accordingly in hyperglycemia depending on the extent of bioreduction. This allows rapid response to subtle changes in glucose levels. They do not cause hypoglycemia, unlike insulin subcutaneous injections and some oral agents like sulfonylureas. This makes patches safer as patients are less worried about experiencing a hypoglycemic episode and gives prescribers greater peace of mind during prescribing. These patches appeal to many patients because they are painless. Short microneedles avoid contact with pain nerve fibers in deeper dermis. Their small sizes make them easy to be carried around.
Some barriers include these patches are tested on mice but not yet in human. Their next plan is to test in pigs whose skin is more similar to human and to understand systemic insulin release kinetics in larger animals. Besides, patients may have immune reactions due to repeated exposure to the numerous components of these patches. UV irradiation during fabrication may affect insulin stability and subsequently its safety and efficacy. Another barrier is beta cells can release insulin in anticipation of food, while smart insulin patch will only release insulin after a rise of glucose level is detected in the interstitial fluid. Demands for these patches diminish if pancreatic beta cells can be replaced.
Next, we move on to the second clinical area, the central nervous system, the brain.
The first disease is cerebral palsy. CP is an umbrella term including a group of disorders of varying degrees of motor, sensory and cognitive impairment due to an injury to the developing fetal brain. It is associated with focal necrosis around the ventricles as well as diffuse ongoing activation of microglial and astrocyte in the immature white mater. Microglia are immune cells found in the brain. Once activated, they trigger release of free radicals, pro-inflammatory cytokines and excitotoxic metabolites. These exaggerate inflammatory response leading to brain injury. When inflammation becomes severe, astrocytes can no longer protect the neurons from oxidative injury. Currently, there are no cure for this condition. CP can be so difficult to treat because different types of brain cells, astrocyte, microglia, oligodendrocyte, neuron, or their connections, myelin sheath, can become damaged. Various strategies are being investigated such as stem cell therapies, but a complete cure is unlikely to emerge in near future. Scientists expect future treatments aim at protecting or repairing the damaged brain cells before their deaths. Hence, I will not address stem cell therapies any further but focus on attenuating sustained neuroinflammation in CP in this essay. Moreover, CP is only diagnosed sometime after birth. This makes postnatal treatment of a prenatal insult to brain very difficult. Furthermore, the diffuse nature of injury or inflammation makes local brain delivery impossible. Blood-brain barrier (BBB) poses a challenge for drugs to get across to reach the ventricles and the white matter.
Cannon and the team used nanoparticles, i.e. polyamidomine, PAMAM, dendrimers as vehicles to deliver N-acetyl-L-cysteine, NAC, intravenously into rabbits with CP phenotypes. Dendrimers are synthesized to mimic natural globular proteins to facilitate transport across BBB to diffuse target sites. NAC is an antioxidant or anti-inflammatory agent. Rabbits which received single 4 treatment of NAC conjugates with NAC at 10 mg/kg within 6 hours of birth showed marked improvement in motor function while taking steps and hopping after 5 days when peak myelination occurred. NAC outperformed free NAC even with tenfold greater free NAC concentration than NAC. They found NAC selectively accumulated in activated microglia and astrocytes in white matter of rabbits with CP phenotypes but not in age-matched healthy controls. This is due to impaired BBB integrity in diseased brains or effective vehicles as described above. Conjugation also improves bioavailability and reduces the toxicity of free NAC to the immature brain. This is because free NAC produces excess L-cysteine which is harmful to oligodendrocytes and neurons. Besides, NAC helps to replenish glutathione especially in astrocytes more effectively than free NAC. Consequently, astrocytes can resume their neuroprotective roles against oxidative stress. Effective passive targeting with nanoparticles to deliver therapeutics during postnatal period to treat a prenatal injury opens up a new window of opportunity for treatment to begin at the very early stages of life. Hopefully, with other non-invasive, in vivo imaging technologies like PET and MRI scans to detect neuroinflammation, CP patients develop less motor and cognitive deficits.
One of the barriers to clinical adoption is that even closest animal models, in this case rabbits in terms of white matter development, microglial presence, oxidative insult, impaired myelination, neuronal loss, hindlimb involvement, still do not match human conditions exactly. Clinical trials need to be done on human to check whether DNAC works in human. Another potential barrier is the promises of other therapies which may cure CP. This may result in funding being channeled away from this nanotechnology because this method does not offer a cure but helps to modify the disease course. Despite there is no subsequent progress in this technology after 2012, I think it is still a promising strategy given limited progress of other approaches.
The second disease is glioblastoma multiforme. GBM is the most aggressive and common brain tumors in adults with very low median survival, 12 to 15 months after standard treatment, surgical resection and radiotherapy and/or chemotherapy. Chemotherapy consists of carmustine delivered locally as BCNU gliadal wafer or systemically as temozolomide, TMZ. Gliadal wafers are associated with many complications like cerebrospinal fluid leak, impaired wound healing, intracranial abscess, meningitis, seizures and tumor cyst formation. Besides, wafers cannot fit the shape of resection sites exactly and may migrate and end up in unintended sites. Moreover, carmustine released from the wafer is not long enough, at most 1 week, and cannot penetrate deep into surrounding brain tissues. On the other hand, BBB is an effective pharmacological and physiological barrier for oral agents like TMZ, preventing accumulation of cytotoxics at therapeutic doses at tumor sites without inflicting many side effects. Furthermore, GBM cells have intrinsic or acquired resistance against these alkylating agents. They upregulate DNA repair pathways, for example mismatch and base excision repairs, and overexpress epidermal growth factor receptors and 6-methylguanine methyltransferase (MGMT) to survive. The latter enzyme helps to reverse the cytotoxic action of temozolomidae. Moreover, the recurrences rate after surgeries is very high. 80% to 90% of recurrences are confined within 2 centimeters of the original tumor site. The highly malignant cancerous cells in the primary tumor proliferate and infiltrate nearby healthy brain tissues, forming micrometastases. They are difficult to be removed completely and safely. In light of this, local drug delivery during surgeries seems very promising.
Bastiancich and colleagues designed a simple formulation of hydrogel consists of 2 ingredients only, i.e. lipid nanocapsules, LNCs, and anti-cancer prodrug lorawyl gemcitabine, GEMP-12. This advanced material can be injected into and adapt to the shape of tumor resection cavity using 30G needle syringes. It adheres to the brain parenchyma and slowly releases the drug to eradicate surrounding micrometastases. Lipid nanocapsule is made up of a hydrophobic triglycerides core with an outer layer of non-ionic surfactants and polyethylene glycol, PEG, molecules. Gemcitabine is an excellent radiosensitizer. It is not affected by MGMT. It is conjugated with lorawyl group. The latter 12-carbon alkyl chain is incorporated into the outer layer of lipid nanocapsules to orientate the drug towards the water phase to form H-bond crosslinks. This immobilizes surrounding water phase to form a gel with compatible mechanical properties. Cumulative drug release in vitro test results suggested sustained release. It was desirable for drug to be released rapidly for the first 2 days to kill residual cancerous cells and then slowly to maintain the cytotoxic activity over a month. As the hydrogel consists of 2 ingredients only, the rate of gel degradation is proportional to rate of drug release. For in vivo evaluation, they injected this hydrogel into mice carrying subcutaneous human glioblastoma tumors. After 8 days, the tumors shrinked significantly or disappeared in mice receiving GEMP-12 lipid nanocapsules compared with mice receiving phosphate-buffered saline, GEMP-12 or lipid nanocapsules only. It is reported to be well tolerated in the short term.
Before this technique is being tried on human, its anti-tumor efficacy has to be established in orthotopic and tumor resection animal models of GBM. Besides, lack of long-term safety data might impede its clinical adoption. As the gel is being degraded, smaller fragments might migrate and kill nearby otherwise healthy tissues. Since gemcitabine release is not selective against cancerous tissues, more side effects will be experienced with greater penetration depth of its release from hydrogel.
In conclusion, the future therapies favor the combination of various technologies like immunotherapy, gene therapy and so on. Hence, we shall all work together for better healthcare of mankind. Here is the list of references that you can have a look at. This is the end of my exam essay.
Please note that any content of this video does not substitute professional medical advices. If you have any health issues, please speak to your doctor and healthcare team. Thank you for watching Lively Life's snippets, and if you like my videos, hit the like and share button. Don't forget to subscribe and see you all in the next episode. Comment below on what type of content you would like to see in the future.